Hello, this is Karen Thompson, CEO of Atlantic Symphony Orchestra. We're a professional regional orchestra located south of Boston on the Massachusetts South Shore. I'm here today with our music director, Jin Kim, for our sixth ASO Thursday Live program. Hi, Jin.
Hi, how are you?
I'm fine. Thanks very much. Before we go on, I'd like to remind our viewers to please leave us some comments. We love to come back and find out where our viewers are coming from. We hope that you feel free to share this program with friends who might be interested. Please give us some likes and some thumbs up. We'd appreciate it.
So today we have two special guests. We have Chelsea Basler soprano, who has been our go-to soprano soloist for years. Plus we have Spencer Aston, who has been our trumpet a player in our trumpet section for a long time as well. So we look forward to that very much. And in addition, once again, a little bit of a mystery thing happening. We're going to be joined by their son, three-year-old son, Emmett. And lastly, but not least, we have yet another person, perhaps that may be joining us at the very end of the program.
Well, I am looking forward to this. And I'm going to scoot out of your way and come back and talk to you when it's over. Thanks so much. Super.
Thank you.
Bye.
Hello, welcome back. Here we are with Spencer Aston and Chelsea Basler. Hi, guys.
Hello.
Hi.
Well, thank you so much for those performances. Could you guys tell us a little bit about why you chose those pieces and, you know, what they're about, maybe?
Sure, I can start with the fanfare. It was a piece that was written, well, they've attributed to Gottfried Reicha, who was J.S. Bach's trumpeter. And they have a portrait of him holding a coiled natural trumpet and a piece of music. And they zoomed in on the music and they were able to look at the notation, and they've created this a facsimile of the fanfare from that painting. I thought that paired nicely with the Neruda, because the Neruda was originally written for a corna da caccia, which again is like a coiled natural trumpet, probably not too far off from what was in the painting that we saw there. So both of those were written around the same time period and probably for a similar type of instrument. They would play the natural horn up in the high register, something that's very difficult for us to do. We have modern horns now that help us to play in all these different registers, but the trumpet players in Bach's time were extremely talented. So there are a lot of fun, some really interesting historical pieces to work on and to learn.
Yeah, I think any brass instrument for that matter, a lot of tubing to be blowing wind through. So in addition to that, Chelsea, the piece that you sang, tell us a little bit about that one.
Sure. So when all of this started, I was having a lot of trouble practicing just anything. And I said to myself, I want to practice things. I want to sing things that make me very happy, that are very beautiful. And I want to sing things that are about nature, because we can't be in nature right now. And Debussy's Nuit d'Étoiles is Night of Stars. There's a lot of, it's an impressionist composer, and there's a lot of words, music, poetry that happens in the piece that describe the outside, the night of the stars, the beautiful fountain, the melancholy feelings that we have. And so I felt like it was timely. I felt like it was beautiful, but that's the song that I sang. As for the duet, that's a Monteverdi piece from Poppea. And it's a bit of a twisted love duet. So us being a couple, we figured, you know, let's do a love duet.
Sure. So that's going to come after our interview here. So the viewers who are not as familiar, obviously, Chelsea, as you just heard, she is a singer and she's sung with our orchestra many a time. She's sort of what I like to call, and very lucky to be saying, our go-to soprano. Great, great singer, great musician, and just always a joy to work with. Same thing with Spencer. You've been with the orchestra now as a trumpet player for how long now? Like 7-8 years, right?
Probably, yeah. I just did a couple seasons as a kind of a permanent sub, I guess you could
yeah,
say.
Yeah.
I was a sub, but you called me for a lot of the concerts, and then you held an audition and was fortunate enough to get a permanent seat in the section. So
yeah, well,
been several years now.
I mean, we're so happy that both of you are able to continue to be with the orchestra. Obviously, Spencer, freelance work and all the performing work has pretty much dried up during this time. And I know both of you teach. I know Chelsea has a private studio, and you also teach probably privately as well as at a university level. How's
yes.
that been?
It's been a learning curve. we had to go online. So we broke for spring break when everything started getting canceled. And the university said, let's take an extra week. So we actually had 2 weeks for spring break, and we came back, everything was online. So I had to convert all of my classes to online in addition to all the private teaching, which musically is challenging. We can't just get together and play because there's a lag. So when you're teaching a lesson, I can't play duets with my students or anything like that. So we have to sort of work through some of those challenges, but it's definitely been a learning curve. Fortunately, a lot of our students now have plenty of time to practice, which has been nice.
Well,
that's been the one upside, I think. But
That's been sort of, I think, the underlying theme for all the musicians. This is a time to really kind of hone our craft and just practice and all that, which, yeah. You know, just because you're very good at what you do doesn't mean that you don't have to practice anymore, right? So now with your trumpet, you know, you're not being able to actually go and do lessons outside or in your studio. So both of your studios are at your home now, right?
Yeah, we have a room down in the basement that fortunately does not bleed very much upstairs. So we're able to practice and play down there and not really bother anybody upstairs and what they're doing, sleeping or eating or relaxing or something
okay.
like that. So we're very fortunate to have a studio space that can accommodate us so we can practice when we need to.
We also have to have a pretty strict calendar schedule because we both need to practice, obviously. We shouldn't practice at the same time. So we have to make sure that, you know, okay, you're going to practice during this time of the day. I'm going to practice during this time of the day. And we also try to make it around we have a two-year-old, our son's schedule so that, you know, one of us is watching him at some point. So we kind of have to do a little bit of the dance that way.
Wow. You're sort of a hall manager and production coordinator and everything all at once. You know, so both of you have undoubtedly very loud instrument. Chelsea, you have a booming voice, as beautiful as it is. Trumpet is certainly not a soft, timid instrument. You're very lucky that, you know, the sound doesn't bleed up so much. How do you deal with that? I mean, even before the COVID situation, I mean, this is something that I'm sure you guys had to deal with.
Like Spencer said, we're actually super lucky because downstairs, so we're in a condo community, and downstairs there are firewalls on either side of us, and both neighbors have said they can't hear anything.
Oh.
And it really absorbs the sound. Also, I think just the way that we've laid out the studio, as every musician does, we have a ton of books and music, which absorbs sound too. It makes it difficult. It's pretty dead down there for a singer. I do like to have a little acoustic to add into my voice. But, you know, it's great for practice space. And honestly, we really cannot hear barely any through the floor. It's not that bad. If we were in a situation where we didn't have this, I don't know how we would do it.
Yeah.
Because, especially for my son who, you know, if we put on the blender, he says too loud. So,
wow. Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah.
Now with your basement all set up, now all you need to do is just have him hone in that on the rhythm section and he can play percussion. It sounds like you guys are all making a great adjustment to all this. So other than teaching, I know with Spencer as well as Chelsea, I know you have a very active schedule traveling and performing as a singer. And first of all, even before this crisis hit, tell us what life is like as an in-demand soloist.
Well, usually you're very busy. I, for example, in the fall, I went to New York, and usually when you go and you do a show, you're there for a month prior in rehearsals, and then for a couple of weeks to a month, depending on the house that you're working at, to do the performances, and you live there. You go and, for example, I was in New York for a month and a half, I think, doing Menno. And, you know, I rent an apartment. I live there. I get to see my family via FaceTime. It's not very different from what all of us are having to do right now. And I get to go home on occasion, but most of the time I'm there for a good period of time. And when you are blessed enough to work a lot, you do go from venue to venue, maybe only having a couple weeks at home at a time, and kind of making it work that way. I was also fortunate in the fall so I was working at the Met, and then I came back and actually worked with Boston Lyric Opera. I've been fortunate to have a really good relationship with them, especially living here, so that I can be home with my son during that time. I was supposed to go back to New York right after all of this started.
April.
Yeah, in April. And I was sad to see that contract taken away once everything went down. But yeah, that's kind of how it is. You go from place to place, you live there, you kind of become a community within each opera performance, within each rehearsal. And then you come home and it's kind of like you've been gone for a month. You have 2 weeks back as family life, full-time mom. And then I go back and do it again.
And how is Emmett adjusting to all this?
He was actually pretty great about it because he didn't know any difference. I started working again when he was, 12 weeks old, maybe even younger than that.
Yeah.
So he knew that, you know, mommy goes to rehearsal. I'm so fortunate that my mom has been able to come out. We have a guest room and she watches my son when I'm on location, I call it. I've been super fortunate to have her do that. So he was very used to, okay, grandma's here. That means mommy goes and does shows. And he also, you know, knows how to FaceTime and things like that. So he didn't really know any different. I will be interested to see, once all of this is over, how he will react to me being gone for long periods of time, because now he's had me for 2+ months.
Uh-huh. Well, we have a couple, you have an Arizona contract and a Boston contract, so he'll be able to be with you on some of those. So
he is going to Arizona.
We can ease into that transition.
A friend of mine sent me one of those one-frame cartoon type of a thing from Europe. And I don't know if you saw this or not, but it was a scene from Bohème. And the cat Jelena Manina, did you see that one with the mask on?
Yeah, and they have the fake hands touching each other.
And then I looked at it, the theme of the opera itself is about pulmonary conditions to begin with. And I'm like, oh my gosh, how things that may be so historic can be so current events, right? You know, right now things are pretty much up in the air. You're not sure exactly what's going to happen, how the staging is going to be. And for that matter, Spencer as well, and for all of us, whenever we do performances, we're not sure how the seating's going to be and everything else. So, I guess we'll soon figure out. I know overseas, as things are beginning to open up a little bit, there's been talk about having, just like, Massachusetts state government is now asking churches to open as well, or actually permitting churches to open with 30-40% occupancy and things like that. So that could happen. But, I guess we'll soon find out, right? As far as just both of you as musician couple, it's with this situation at hand, how do you foresee things kind of moving forward and for you guys?
Well, we keep hoping that, our next contract won't be canceled. Mm. I keep hoping that there is going to be a future for all of us as opera singers, as classical musicians. There's like glimmers of hope coming out of Europe where they do have some performances happening. More studies are being done about how much aerosol is permitted into the air with trumpet players, orchestras. They did say that singers are super spreaders because of our lung capacity and how much we admit. But, yeah, which is kind of a bummer for people like me. Mm-hmm. But I just keep hoping that, there is hope for the future of the art form of opera as a classical singer, not just for myself, but for everybody. It would be a real shame if COVID is the thing that kills opera. I can't see that as COVID being the thing that kills opera, because it hasn't been killed in how many years already? And there has been other pandemics. There have been other things that have happened. And I just keep looking to the next contract. So my Tanglewood contract in August was canceled, but my Arizona opera contract has not been yet. So that's the next thing I look to. I hope that that would be the next thing. I hope that my Boston Lyric Opera thing would be the next thing. That's kind of how I'm continuing to look forward and to move forward through this crazy time that we're all experiencing.
Yeah. And I think, you're right. I mean, there are some concerns, and I'm sure with Spencer, we're basically in the same boat performance-wise. Teaching-wise, sounds like it, regardless whether we go back into classrooms or not, the whole remote thing is probably going to go on for a while and be, kind of a backup situation. My sense is, as difficult as these times may be, both of you play instrument where there's a lot of exhaling happening, and inhaling too, of course. But, there are professional athletes and everybody as well who probably does even more. And also the fact that I think, if anything, the current situation has taught us and really made it clear how human interaction and how live music, I think, is so important in our lives. Mm-hmm. You could only do so much only. I mean, you can do that, that like that cartoon of someone touching each other with a hand stick, and I think it will come back, and it should. And I can't imagine life without that happening. So not only, just being hopeful, but I'm very much looking forward to this all getting figured out. Now, for the second half of this video performance, you are featuring a couple things. You talk about the Monteverdi that you're going to be doing together. And we have a very special piece at the end, right?
This is sort of our nightly performance routine.
Oh, wow. Every day?
Every day. Every bedtime.
Twice a day.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Naps, too.
Yeah. So Emmett, when he was very little, there was a show that we would put on that had a cartoon going with Tchaikovsky's violin concerto. Oh, wow. And when he was fussing or crying and we put that on, he was just fixed to it, would love the music. So, and of course we would always sing to him. And so music has always sort of been part of our daily routine. And so every night when we go to bed, we put him ready for bed, we read a story and we sing some songs to him. He has his favorites that he requests every night, including Jingle Bells, which has not left our rotation yet since December.
Sometimes Jingle Bells happens twice.
Wow. Sounds like a mini concert every time.
The voice it is.
That's wonderful. Well, we'll look forward to folding that into the video mix as we listen to that. So thank you so much for joining us today. And this actually concludes what we call a mini-series featuring our musicians in a remote way. Things are beginning to open up. We obviously have to continue to do our part to keep everything safe and be mindful of each other, because after all, it's not just about our health, but people around us as well. And so I just want to thank you again, and I very much look forward to working with both of you again very, very soon.
We're looking forward to it. Thank you.
Yes, all right. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.
Dad does just look in. Do you want any other songs? Is that it?
I want horses and coconuts.
Okay. Hush-a-bye, don't you cry. Go to sleep, my little baby. When you wake, you will find all the pretty little horses. Cockles and maids, pinters and greys. Lovely, pretty little horses.
That child doesn't look like he's going to sleep anytime soon.
He did tell me that he did go to sleep much quicker than you thought. And what's amazing is they were also telling me that they've been singing and playing for him, you know, since he was a little toddler.
Yeah, sure.
They do this twice every day, one before nap time and one before he goes to sleep. Good news is that he sleeps just twice a day. 11 hours throughout the night, and you know, usually, I'm sure there may be some exceptions, and then 3-4 hour naps. So that's a good thing.
I'm very impressed. It's a winning formula. Good job. Speaking of good jobs, I want to thank you. It's been a pleasure doing this with you over the last 6 weeks. Thanks so much.
Oh, thank you, and you've been a great person to bring this to everybody here. And, you know, as you can see, we have wealth of talent in our musician pool. So it was really wonderful to kind of reconnect them in this kind of way. And we look forward to having them back again sometime soon.
Yeah, absolutely. I hope so. So before we say goodbye, I'd like to just remind our viewers to please leave us a comment. Let us know where you're watching from. We love to find out where our viewers come from. Please feel free to share this with your friends who'd be interested and leave us some thumbs up and some likes.
Before we go, we do have that one extra special mystery thing happening. Yeah. And so just hold on just a second.
Okay. Who's coming? Noah!
So this is baby Noah. Noah, over here. So he has been with us for about 6 months. And along with her, or his, I should say, 11-year-old sister, we have been all hunkered down like everybody else at home.
Oh, what a joy. Hello, sweetheart. Hi, baby. Oh, I'm so glad you brought him on. Thank you. So you are in, my kids are all older. So it's not quite the same. Now, how is Noah sleeping? Is he 11 hours and 4 hours?
Well, not quite, but he's been doing very well too. So ever since he came home from the hospital, he's been sleeping through the night for the most part.
Wow.
And so we are very lucky.
Good baby.
Knock on wood.
Thanks so much for bringing him on. It's a pleasure.
Of course. Yeah. And we certainly look forward to great health for everybody. And we look forward to seeing everybody in real person in a concert situation sometime very, very soon. So thank you so much for all your support.
Thank you, everybody. Thanks for being with us and take care. We hope to see you again real soon.
Bye-bye. Say bye. Bye.